system, and charge and flux, perhaps space qubits, and about single shot readout made on these subjects. And then this is a new result with altitude adjustable coupling. And so there are a few schemes. I'll cover this. One of it is AC coupling scheme. And lastly, the important issue is how does the system decohere? I'll cover some of our findings. This is our member. We have about 10 people. And the core is NEC, and everything experiment was done in NEC Tsukuba. And since NEC as an industry cannot really support this level of research, we have 100% collaboration. Partnership with RECAN, this is Element Lab. And they rent the office and floors in NEC. And we have another set of funding from CREST, which is JSD, government funding. Okay, and main player for single shot, Josephson qubit, we have charge flux. Charge qubit is mainly done by Nakamura. Flux is now by Yoshihara. And single shot readout by Baldick. And AC coupling scheme is now launched by Ante Neskinen. And decoherence, many people play key roles. We have many major so before it starts, I'll just cover Josephson junction very quickly. It's a Josephson junction is just two superconductors weakly coupled by some means, and we typically use tunnel junctions. And this we have macroscopic quantum macroscopic states at both sides, and the phase difference at the boundary gives a supercurrent, maximum supercurrent. Supercurrents. Can be related to the phase. Phase is typical quantum mechanical quantity, and that can be read out as a macroscopic quantity of test current. So this is called macroscopic quantum system. And the degree of freedom of such a system is very limited. One is phase difference, and there's another one that we typically use conjugate of the phase is number of one of the island. And this, so we can play this as two type of degrees of freedom to build up the qubits. And how to make it? This is just one example. It's called flux qubit, taking use of flux degree of freedom. If you have a superconducting loop, flux is complex. And this is Josephson junction here. And so to use flux states, and the flux can be controlled using external magnetic field. And flux can become macroscopic quantum in and out of the loop. And the charge qubit, which looks very similar, but in this case we can make the charging energy of the island much larger than the Josephson energy of this coupling. So in this case, so you just make everything smaller. Charge number of Cooper pair is the quantum number of this system. So we can make use of neighboring charge states. And these two qubits are the experiment has been carried out. The first one we made was charged to, but I'll show the data later. But so in terms of energy band, just look at the lowest two bands, and you have two bands that forms qubit, And this is charge axis. You have another degree of freedom, which is flux, external flux, and this is energy. And this cross section is strong when charging energy is small. This is charging energy large. And you can operate the system at any point of this energy band. But we do have, because of the system are coupled to external environment. And environment typically, if you have sort of coupling, you have decoherence. And we have identified many sources of decoherence source. And typically, 1 over F noise of background charge or flux, we do not know the microscopic origin of these things, but we do know they exist. And if they have, if you have such a fluctuation in flux or charge from the background, your energy, so that your bias point will fluctuate, that will give you the fluctuation in qubit energy. So that the fluctuation of qubit energy gives you a fluctuation in the phase, and its phase fluctuation accumulate to 2 pi, you have decoherence. So the trick against these fluctuations is you operate the system at these protected points. The band is flat. So this is the, we call it the magic point, the sweet point, or degeneracy point. So these are the favorable place to work on. And you apply microwave up here. So these are two strategies. Here, you have a microscopic tunneling of Kuiper pair, coherent tunneling of Kuiper pair. Here you have a coherent tunneling of the flux. Two different physics, this system. And the first qubit experiment in solid states is this. This is a charged qubit experiment. And instead of working at the degeneracy point here, at that time, we didn't know what's the optimized point. We initiate the system up here, and we apply a very fast pulse, non-adiabatic pulse, into the system so that system operates up from here, suddenly jumps to this degeneracy point. And here, when charge states differ from this state, system going to quantum oscillation, and then you end the oscillation lasts a delta t time, which is the Cauchy twist, and you stop that, and you have probability of the states coming up here, depends on the amount of delta t, and then if you wait here for a while, this system is tuned at so-called, have a photograph, but there is a tunneling probe to the qubit, and after say 10 nanoseconds, it was tuned that two states which have one Kuiper pair, extra Kuiper pair, this state will decay down to zero states by emitting two quasi particles, and we just made use of this quasi particle as the readout. And as you can see, if this in tunnels out, it is the immediate back action that will destroy these two states. And the result of the quantum oscillation is here. This is pulse width, delta t, and you see the oscillation. Higher one is the probability of, or amplitude, the probability of these two states. Okay. And this is one pulse, and we can do two pulse interference. And then you can have three pulse echo experiment so that you can have longer decoherence time and you can control the phase of the two qubit. And this is another version, flux qubit, similar technology, everything's now made larger. This is 2 micron of a loop. we have four Josephson junction here. And this is readout squid. And in this case, we worked, everything was worked at degeneracy point. And this is the result that quantum oscillation, we apply microwave pulse at degeneracy point. And this is the, so far, the best data we get. After echo cancel activation technique, we get like T2 times this dephasing time after echo, 3.5 microseconds. And relaxation time T1 is 1.8 microseconds. Decoherence, dephasing is not purely limited by relaxation. We have some extra dephasing mechanism. We suspect I'll cover that later. So, in terms of decoherence time, other labs, the best so far achieved was either both in charge and flux field, which is about 7 microseconds. Roughly, this is the ballpark here at the present experimental stage. And how to read out the previous, this is the result of more or less single shot measuring. You can see as the visibility, it's reaching 90%. But the previous one, the charge one, is not really a single shot. You're reading the averaging of the current with Josephson quasi-particle cycle. So how do you read out this charge? So okay, this is the first example, but we are averaging. This is not single shot. You read the current as and then monitor the N. But we have to do single shot measurements for many of the quantum information processing. And another one, this is applying for our flux qubit, or it can be applied to charge too. It's just looking at the switching current of this extra large junction. You can tune the system so that the switching of this tunnel junction only happens when you have particular polarity of the circulating current. So that will can be used to distinguish clockwise and counterclockwise current. After we read the scene, as you can see, you have a strong current state that will really, you cannot do the quantum non-dimulation thing. Another possibility is just using single-action tunneling or single-action transistor as a sensor for the charge. And this has the capability to read at 1 hertz. You can read something like 10^-5 E. So it's very easy to read single extra charge. But the problem is that the bandwidth of SET is really narrow, typically 10 kilohertz, and you can decohere much faster than this bandwidth. So this is no use. You have to think of something else. For instance, radio frequency SET. But in this experiment, we put another dot here, so that we transfer extra Cooper pairs to this trap, and it will be trapped there for a millisecond, a long time. And then you have much time to read it out, essentially. This is the experiment. So this is charge qubit with the trap. This is charge qubit here. The length is slightly less than 1 micron. And we transfer this extra Cooper pair from here through tunnel junction here to this trap. And this tunneling can be achieved by putting a pulse here, putting a potential here. So you can initiate the tunneling. And then you can read the CT as the readout. And in terms of back action, we haven't really studied about back action too carefully. What I can say is that since we're passing current through here and see the change of the current as the readout, so perhaps you have back action with this current, do this charge stay skip. But since there's a trap to screen all these things, so that experimentally, this is we know, we can operate SET with the current flowing states or Coulomb blockade states. And both can be used as the readout. And we didn't see any difference in these two states. So that the back action from current is negligible. So experimentally, the easiest one is that we just keep pumping a pipe pulse. We always make the state one after pipe pulse. And then you read out the system and check the SET current. This is the typical example. So this state is always one. You have one extra quasi particle, extra couple pair. And we have a readout pulse pulsing this trap. And this is the result of SET current. And as you can see, these are one means you have a dip in the current showing this is. This is Coulomb blockade states, this is current states. The system moves to less current states. So this is one. We read out the system successfully. One, and there's a missing something. So this is error. So by doing some statistics, we know the efficiency of the readout. And also, as you can see, this is a single shot measure. This is one event. And so this is the typical, because these pulses are not really ideal, we have to adjust the biasing condition slightly. But anyway, the visibility is about 67%. And mainly, let me comment here, this efficiency or visibility is not 100% because the readout is not efficient. Not only the readout is not efficient, and also partially because the pipe pulse we apply as non-adiabatic pulse is not perfect. It's not infinitely sharp pulse. We know this is roughly 80% efficiency. And this is the analysis we have carried out. This is qubit. We have a reservoir here. We have a tunnel junction. And we have zero or one states. And what will happen is that one state can be read out with a rate alpha to the trap. But also it can move back. This one state will spit back polyparticle into reservoir and relax. This is relaxation process. And also, zero states where you are not supposed to read out anything, but we have some particular dark current flowing there. So the best thing is this is low rate, this is high rate, this is low rate. That will give you a very high efficiency for reading. And we have carried out experiments to see what's these rate. So putting the delay time between control pipe pulse and readout pulse, you have this exponential decay in the signal of the CT current, and decay exponentially in the time constant of this 120 nanoseconds, that gives you data. Another set of the data is that you put the pipe pulse and then immediately you put the readout pulse and see how fast it saturates. And that gives you alpha. This is consistent with thickness of the oxide we have here. And see, this is much longer than that, so we are happy. And also, without this pipe pulse, we just change this, we also get some signal. If you wait long enough, you see some dark current flowing, which is rather long, microseconds, so close. But we do have some elevator. And so with all these things, efficiencies of 0 and 1 as the readout is nearly 90%. Okay, this is very high efficiency. And also, in particular, this zero state readout. If there's any many interpretation of quantum non-demolation measure, here we are not destroying zero states. But not in one state. One state you have transfer. But I guess if you can feed it back, if you know this became zero after it was one but zero, but then with that information you can feed it back with another pipe pulse, we can flip it back to one, and maybe this is another interpretation of QMD. Okay, so that's one qubit system. Let me change to a two qubit system. And this is first example, two charged qubits. This is the photograph. This is not obvious, but these two qubits are coupled with capacitance, overlaying capacitance. So this is the cross-section image. Everything is made of aluminum, and this red part is surface oxide, the aluminum oxide, and we put this overlay capacitor here. Okay. And so we have this is coupling term, charge coupling. So what we did in this experiment is that since we have two oscillators, we can make two qubits to oscillate the quantum oscillator, go into quantum oscillations. And also with these DC gates, we can control, we can make both of them to oscillate, or one only is oscillate at the time.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Why do you need two oxide layers between the two qubits? In this way, you have two oxide layers coming between the qubits. Right?
This is not the qubit. This is qubit.
Yeah, yeah. The oxide layer. I mean, the oxide layer will act as a dielectric, right?
Yes.
So you have two dielectrics coming in between the two qubits. Right?
This gives you a coupling. Maybe you're saying that if you have if this qubit overlay directly to
right.
This guy, yeah, technically that's hard. Yeah, that's not so easy. But this is much easier. And okay, so both. So if you make two qubits to oscillate independently, they have this. As you can see, this is really nice. Sinusoidal oscillation. This is a frequency component. And this is just one single frequency. And with that, we can the period is h or h over ej, so we get aj nicely. Different ejs, Josephson energy. And now here, welcome to oscillation. So are made when to make both of them oscillate at the same time. Now it's very complicated, and this colored lines are sticking. And these are frequency components, and this black arrows are predicted location of these two peaks, given that we know what's the coupling strength from independent measurement. So we can predict the location of these arrows. So the current result verifies these arrows. And the physics here is that you have two oscillators completely coupled. You have these beating, just like in classical oscillators. So we know you have a coherent quantum oscillator here. And so the entanglement is there somewhere. We cannot really directly see the entanglement because this readout is we're reading the averaging current, so we cannot establish the correlation of these two readouts. But what we can do is that since we have these simulation results, and with this simulation we can what simulation do is that you're really calculating these amplitude after the fitting. You know these amplitude of these four components, and with that you can calculate any entanglement measures. In this particular case, the entanglement is really achieved in this system. Right after that, we try to make a quantum gate out of that. Now we have, instead of one pulse gate, we have two pulse gates that we can control the qubit independently. So how does it work? So this is the stability diagram of the charge states. X and Y axis is the voltage applied to these two gates. And without any voltage, systems are in 0-0 state. And if you apply more and more voltage, the first qubit flips. And if you go this second qubit flips, and here you have 1-1 states. And this is the energy diagram on top of that, here. And this is the cross section taken at this direction, here. And we have four bands for two qubits, looking at the lowest four bands. And the idea is this: we start from 0-0 states and we apply pi pulse aimed at this line. So the height of the pulse is designed to get here. And we start from 0-0 and this pi pulse will flip this state. The second qubit is flipped. Second qubit is the target qubit. Target qubit gets flipped. 2-0-1. But if you are in 1-0, when control qubit is 1, then the same pulse cannot make it to the degeneracy point, so 1-1 cannot be achieved. 1-0 is 1-0. Nothing happens. So that means 1-0 is 1-0. 0-0 goes to 0-1. This is conditional operation. I only have 1 and 0 as in control. We try to create the superposition of 0 and 1 and see what happens. This is the experiment. And to carry out that, this works with these multiple pulses. For instance, these are the stability diagram here, and on top of that is the energy band. We put two pulses in two different directions. Singh Art House. And before that, we put this pass to prepare superposition of 0 and 1, 1 in control qubit. And after this pass, we create that. This is the entangled space. And in this this is more challenging. We have to move the states to higher states. So initially, you put one pass into this direction, so making the states here, and then put the pass in different direction and move it high up. It's a bit complicated, but it works. So that is here, and after entanglement system is here. This is before. And after high pass, we get something like that. So this is the result of the experiment. You're reading out the current. And this axis, we're changing by the width. Actually, we're changing the magnetic field, but we can say we're changing the width of the pass, so that you're changing this alpha and beta. And this is the result of the control gate and target gate. So over here, this is the first qubit is control, this is target, control target. And in between, we have, so this is the truth table. With that, we get that in between. And this is when target target gate is 1. Now we have very different. This is complicated. We have 3 paths here. And this is 0, 0, 1, 1 there. And in between, you get another candidate states in the middle. Okay. So this is the first demonstration. So this is not very good because this capacitance is always on. We cannot really control it. Since we cannot turn off the coupling, we cannot do this simple unconditional manipulation of the qubit. If you turn something, the other qubit also turns. So ideally, we need some adjustable coupling here. Many theoretical proposal, and no experimental demonstration to be done yet. So what is what quality do you want for this controllable coupling? This should be no dissipation. No residual coupling. Coupling is just there. Coupling strength should be strong so that you have fast C naught operation. Switching has to be fast if you want to switch on and off of these coupling. It should be scalable. You can should be able to make lots of qubits. And also very important is that you should be able to operate the system at the optimal point, saddle point here, so that it's immune or more immune to external fluctuation in charge and flux. And we have done 2 experiments, and we're doing trying to do the 3rd different scheme. So this is charged qubit. 2 charged qubit can be controlled. It can be in degeneracy point or outside of the degeneracy point. And instead of using capacitance, here this is controlled by inductance. And this inductance can be a Josephson inductance or a linear inductance, doesn't matter. And this is proposal. And now we only have 2 qubit. Right. Okay. And this is the energy. And this is the coupling terms here. And this can be controlled. Chi is function of the external magnetic field here. And it can be controlled, system can be controlled by this external flux. This is the trick. Flux is zero, no coupling, no finite flux gives you coupling. And the scheme is that I only plotted 2 qubits, but it can be extended to many, many qubits in the original proposal, assuming this inductance dominates all these parasitic inductors. Then many qubits can be coupled at the same time, and you can pick any qubits by turning on and off qubit frequency by local magnetic field, can tune your Josephson energy. So you pick 2 qubits that you want to couple. So this is proposal. So this is the first experiment. This is, since the inductance has to be large, instead of linear inductor, we put a Josephson inductor, just Josephson junction. And this is 2 qubits. And here. And we have this small we created the small island here, which is here. And we tried to reduce the fluxation in charge, because this is a small island. We have a large EJ, EC, charging energy. We try to reduce that by putting a capacitor, shunting capacitor. So this is the shunting capacitor we made. So this is the scheme. And we have done the spectroscopy with the system. So this is the result. We have, okay, this is the JQP, Josephson quasi-particle peak. Was used as a detection as previous case. So this is the gate voltage, this is current. You see these pictures? And see, so to do the spectroscopy, we could apply microwave. And this is the microwave induced JQP peak. It's called photon assisted JQP here. And tracing, we're changing the gate and changing frequency. We can plot out the upper band energy. So this is the result. We have this upper band here. And this is JQP, and these are noise. Try to ignore this lot of noise. Computer just thinks these are the peaks, but actually these are noise. So this is the upper band. And now this is done without when magnetic field is zero, and we turn on magnetic field slowly in these two pictures. As you can see, a gap develops here. Some sort of anti-crossing. And when we plot so this is like anti-crossing. And this happened to be the plasma frequency of the coupling junction. So, and this is the outcome. The location of this energy is constant. This is magnetic field. We're changing the coupling strength here. The location doesn't change, but the strength, the gap size, is changing in more or less sinusoidal way, like sine function. We have a peak here. And this is reasonable. And we think now that this is due to the coherent coupling between the qubit and coupling junction. We have coherent couple system, and also we're changing the coupling strength. And next thing, obvious things to do, is to see the quantum beaking of this two oscillation. So this is a similar experiment. So this is a stability diagram in charge. If you operate the system at this edge, only the first qubit oscillates. So this is 1 qubit oscillation. If you do it here, you have coupled oscillation. as previous example, we start to see a beating like more complicated pattern. Perhaps these are nodes. Another junction. This junction is noisier. We have some switching noise, so we cannot tell too much for this particular case. And we plotted out this core oscillation and tried to find a systematic change in the nodes if beating. And this, we're changing the magnetic field, right? And when we compare with the previously obtained chi, which is coupling strength, we are supposed to see nodes at these points. The corresponding experiment is not revealing exact correspondence, but something is definitely changing this magnetic field. We cannot really say too much. This experiment is going on, trying to confirm this. But definitely we have coupling between, coupling junction and the field. This is established. Another thing we're changing or doing is more obvious. Suppose we have two qubits, charge qubits, coupled by capacitance this way, and we have this neutral panel. Suppose you have a switch here, and if you switch, and the other side of switch is grounded, when switch is off, you have coupling. This island is floating, and if you switch this on, everything is grounded, and this potential is fixed, so you don't have any coupling, assuming you don't have any residual capacitive coupling. This is obvious way to do the on-off. And what kind of switch you can use? There are many. In this experiment, we choose a semiconductor transistor. So this is the experiment. We built two charge qubits on top of two-dimensional Erentz gas. And this is the, we do the mass etching. So we have a two-deck below qubit, and there's a switch. And when switch is closed, everything is ground. This pink region is two-dimensional Erentz gas. You couldn't see it, but it should be here. And so when we do, we have a gate here, and just look at the change in SET. So this is SET, right? So we look at the SET current modulation by gate. And this is typical SET oscillation. And the period of this oscillation gives you the value of this capacitance, gate capacitance, from gate to independent qubit. Now, we switch off. The gate is now off, so now we have a floating island. So everything is coupled strongly here. Now, we did the same thing, a very big difference. The capacitance changed about 10 times, as expected. So this is a very good way to switch on and off. And further, we checked. Traced out the stability diagram, and this is just monitoring one of the currents. So this, when the switch is off, there is no coupling straight line. As you can see here, when switch is on, when you have a coupling, this line is zigzag. So amount of this zig or zag gives you the amount of coupling capacitance. This is consistent with the geometry. So we can turn qubit on and off. Unfortunately, this ran the EJ of the Josephson energy of the qubits are slightly too small. So we haven't seen the is the qubit quantum oscillation. Yeah, good. Will come out soon. Another experiment with. And in many cases, it's limited by the relaxation time. And in charge, we know this relaxation time is limited strongly by flux, charge fluctuation. But for flux qubit, we still do not really know what's that. Some sort of external noise. So we are reaching like 7 or a few microseconds. 7 is the highest so far. And the question is maybe how far you can push this. Cannot really say. If this is a limitation of the, for instance, spontaneous emission coupling to the environment gives you like milliseconds. But something else is coming in. But even with 7 microseconds, you can have qubit energies. Okay, thank you for waiting. All right, let me continue. Another scheme. We are just starting that for flux qubit, we have a proposal saying coupling 2 qubits with 3rd qubit in the middle, and we apply when this qubit energy is much larger than this 2 energy, then we can use the difference in frequency of this detuned frequency of this 2 qubit apply to the 3rd qubit. You can couple on and off the qubit, and this is we are starting to do the experiment using these 2 qubits here, 3rd qubit, and we have this 1 readout. This is starting another scheme, so we are testing out several schemes. And okay, so that's the story. 2 qubit system, and finally, is the rest of the time, and a few slides for decoherence. And I am not going into too much of the details, but it gives you the flavor of what we're doing. And so this plot is analysis of flux qubit, and we are trying to get gamma 1, gamma 2 at very different points of the bias. This is flux bias, this is current bias. Current bias meaning this is 3 qubits. Qubit also depends on the read. This is the current piece for the readout squid, and the amount of these current can control the decoherence process probably means you have a noise in this system, and you will split noise split into 2 and goes out. And if these 2 branches are perfectly balanced, then qubits are immune or less affected by these noise. But if you have slight imbalance, these noise couples to the qubit. But because these are nonlinear elements, you have nonlinear inductor here. So you can balance out these tuning by fine-tuning the current. You can balance out these noise sources. So we have 2 things we can tune. One is magnetic field, one is current, and both has an optimal point. And here we have this shape. the central region near here. And this magenta is Ramsey. So what does this mean? Okay. So gamma 2 equals optimal point. And the shape, this is cosine phi 15, that shows you that at near degeneracy point, not at degeneracy point, we have long wave charge fluctuation. Oh, that's right. So it shows that this this point doesn't really come down to zero. So we have extra decoherence source there. And over here it shows high frequency current noise. And you have low frequency pulse. And also this is plotting out the decay. We're adjusting the difference between high pulse and the readout pulse. And looking at this decay dependence. And this black, we're doing several fitting. On the degeneracy point, everything can fit by exponential decay, but off degeneracy point, like here, this is degeneracy point. Off degeneracy point, this black one is exponential fit. We cannot really fit that. But when we do Gaussian fitting, it really fits. And what does that mean? That means we have a large inference of long graph noise of the flux kind coupling to this, enhancing the relaxation process. And also, a few examples. This is Ramsey oscillation. It should have rather smooth decay, but as you can see, we have some beacon-like structures. And this, we are modeling this kind of thing with the qubit coupled to a large dominating big two-level fluctuator. And we think this is a charge kind. And this thing will change, detune the qubit from one frequency to the other, back and forth, slowly. So you have, you're creating such a beating-like structure. So you do have all these instruments. And this is the result at the optimal point, or degeneracy point, T1 is, we do not know this. I didn't show you everything, but we have strange structures. Maybe have something to do with readouts, we're not so sure. And T2 is almost limited by T1. But we do have extra decoherence due to perhaps charge noise. And T5, the pure dephasing times roughly 7 microseconds. This is not infinite due to extra charge noise. And we have some slow charge fluctuations. So even for the flux qubit, the message here is that flux noise can be a problem in flux qubit also. And off to our point, again we have some strong limiting factor from T1. And T2 has slow long wave noise background. And high frequency current noise. This has to be filtered out, some sort of filter. This is very hard. People knows about this flux noise starting, you know, from the split measurement. And this has been known for maybe 20, at least 25 years. And the amount is like 10 to the minus 6 flux quanta at 1 hertz. And nobody knows what is this. There there's no theory. For charge fluctuation, there's also no theory. If you have trapped electron in the dielectric, and you can have a particular potential. This one can sort of guess. But flux noise, no one knows about this. So this is a mystery. And data were taken when SET they were biased at current carrying states and Coulombic gate states. I forgot which one's which. Perhaps this black one is current carrying state, white one is the Coulombic gate. But they give about the same results. So the back action is due to the current is minimum. And this is decoherence. So from these curves, we can say the same thing, the similar things. At optimal point, T1, in this case, we know from this curve, we have a sine-like curve here. So we have charge fluctuation is dominating. Perhaps high frequency. Oh, I'll show you the high frequency data later. But this is perhaps high frequency. And T2 is limited by T1. And off degeneracy. So this means here. So T1 and gamma 1, gamma 2 coincide. So this guy's in. And we'll show you why this is high frequency. And off degeneracy point, those high frequency and low frequency charge fluctuations are influenced in these. And this is, we convert qubit energy into frequency, and we got this linear-like noise spectrum. This is very interesting. So this is a quantum noise. The qubit frequency is much lower. The thermal energy, everything is lower. This is very high energy. So we have quantum noise source. Noise analyzed, showing the dominating source is small breath noise, and there's a mystery about T1. This is in especially flux qubits, we do not know. I think we know more about a charge qubit. And inductively, this is adjustable coupling for inductively coupled charge qubit, adjustable coupling by switch, also demonstrated. Okay. That's all.